We just explained that this notion of Grothendieck topology is so rich that it gives another formulation for the problems of provability in geometric logic. So this is really an incredible result. And it makes all the more important the following question. For any geometric theory you are interested in, how to present its classifying topos? So you have the associated classifying topos, ET, and you wonder how to present it in terms of sites. Because any presentation in terms of sites, in terms of a topology J or some category C, will give you a new translation of the problems of probability in T in terms of topologies on C, which contain a J. So the first remark we can make is that for any topos, there are so many presentations in terms of sites that in fact it is not even a set. So this is just because E itself is not a small category. Except the trivial topos with only one object and one row, all other toposes are not small categories. And I remind you that any full subcategory of E which is small and generating give rise to a presentation. So there are incredibly, the ways to present it, it is not even a set. What we have done so far is to say that, of course, there is the presentation of the classifying topos in terms of the syntactic category endowed with a syntactic topology. But this presentation, of course, is not always the best. In particular, it is a presentation which is syntactic in nature. So it is very close to logic. And it would be probably more telling in many instances to have presentations in terms of sites CJ, which are not so closely related to the linguistic presentation of T. Here I should also mention that, in fact, the classifying topos of a theory, in general, has several presentations defined even in syntactic terms. There is a syntactic geometric category we already defined, but there also exist other syntactic presentations. For instance, if the theory T is algebraic, there is a Cartesian, there is a Cartesian syntactic category, the regular syntactic category, the coherent syntactic category, and so on, for different types of presentation. And maybe I can also mention that next week there will be a talk by Joshua Wagner, first year PhD student of Olivia, who will present in particular a new way of constructing the classifying topos of theories, which he has found. So this also is very interesting. But by now, we consider in general the question of presentation of a theory in terms of set. So the first remark we can make is that, of course, if we have such a presentation, then the topos E, equivalent to C hat J, will be a subtopos of the topos C hat, the topos of presheaves on C. And the topos of presheaves on C, as any topos, can be presented as the classifying topos of some theory T prime. And then, because E is a subtopos of C hat, T will appear as a quotient theory of T prime. So we can try to play in this direction. So for that, we need a definition. We You see that the consideration of pre-shift topos and the fact that any topos by definition is a subtopos of a pre-shift topos. So this consideration leads to the following definition. A geometric theory T is called of pre-shift type when its classifying topos can be written as a topos of pre-shifts on a small category. Okay, so of course, not all toposes verify this property. Only parts of the so this is a particular class of toposes. And maybe I should also mention that when you have a pre-shift topos like that, C hat, it can be equivalent to some other presentations, so C hat, C prime at J prime with some non-trivial J prime. So you see, you can define a topos through a non-discrete site and nevertheless get the property that this topos is equivalent to the topos of species on some category. It is a quite subtle question. So there are examples of theories which are of pre-shift type, in fact, which I'll come back to that later, but I immediately state a few examples. First, in any signature sigma, you can consider the so-called empty theory, which is a theory without axioms. And then it is a general fact that this theory is of pre-shift type. Another example of another very important class of pre-shift type theories is a class of algebraic theories. So what is an algebraic theory? It is a theory whose signature has only source and function symbols, no relation symbol, and whose axioms all have the form true implies an equality between terms. Okay, so if you think, for instance, about the theory of groups, what are the axioms? There is associativity of multiplication, the fact that the element one is a unit, the fact that g, the product of g and g minus one in any direction is equal to one. So all of these are equalities between terms. Okay, and it is the same for the theory of rings, of modules over rings, of vector spaces over a field, and so on. Here I am saying that all algebraic theories have pre-shift type. In fact, it is not an obvious fact, it requires a proof. Okay, and then what I want to do in the following minutes is to study in general pre-shift type theories. So for this, first I consider toposes of pre-shifts. So let's consider a topos E, which is a topos of pre-shifts on some category C. And in order to understand better the relationship between E and C, we shall consider an invariant of the topos under consideration, which is the category of its points. So let's consider the category of points of C hat. And of course, the point of C hat is given by Diaconescu's equivalence. And in that way, you prove that the category of points of C hat is equivalent to the category of functors from C to set, which verifies two equivalent properties. So first, the category of its elements, which means the category of objects of X, endowed with an element of P of X, so this category is filtering. And the second equivalent property is the fact that this functor can be written as a filtering collimit of representable functors. So in particular, we get that any representable functor defines a point of C hat. So as a consequence of that, we get that the category of points of C hat is the end completion, the end category built on the opposite category of C. So you see that in this way, the category of points of C hat is computed from C in a quite concrete way. This is the end category, the end completion of the opposite of C. Okay, so this theorem can be proved. And of course, there is a corollary. By now, if we have a pre-shift type theory, whose classifying topos can be written as a topos of pre-shifts on C hat, then we get that the category of models of set theoretic models of T is equivalent to the end category of C opposite, to the end completion of C opposite. And so in order to make that more clear, we just draw the bridge we are considering. So here the invariant under consideration is the category of points of the classifying topos. And the classifying topos is presented in two different ways. On one side, from a theory T, on the other side, from the category C, endowed with a discrete topology. And so you compute the category of points on the two sides. On one side, by definition of the classifying topos, it is a category of set theoretic models. And on the other side, according to our previous theorem, we get the end completion of the opposite category of C. So this means in particular that the end category of C op is determined by T up to equivalence. So by now we can ask to which extent it is possible to recover C from the topos C hat. So far, what we have recovered is the end completion of C op. We did not recover C. So we may wonder whether it is possible to fully recover C or not. So in order to answer this question, we have to introduce the following definition. So let's consider a pre-shift type theory, and let's consider a set theoretic model M, an object of the category of set theoretic models. And then we say that this model is finitely presentable if the functor, the covariant functor associated to M on the category of set theoretic models respect filtering colimits. Okay? And you can check that, for instance, if you think about models of algebraic theories such as groups, rings, and things like that, then the definition of finitely presentable really corresponds to finitely presented groups, which means groups which are defined by a finite family of generators and relations, or rings which are defined by a finite family of generators and relations, and the same for all types of algebraic structures. So this definition really corresponds to what we have in mind, but you see that this is a categorical definition on the category of set theoretic models. And this definition singles out part of the models. Okay, so we can introduce in this category of set theoretic models the full subcategory of models which are finitely presentables. And then we have the following proposition. So let's consider a theory T, which is of pre-shift type, so that the category of its set theoretic models is the end completion of C op. Yes, here I have made a, you see, I have written end of C op hat. I should have removed the hat. Okay. And by now, let's consider a model. And so the proposition tells us that such a model is presentable if and only if it is a splitting of a representable object of C. So if and only if there is an object X of C opposite on the pair of morphisms P on I, whose composite is the identity of M. And you see, this is a pair of morphisms from between M on the representable functor associated to X. So this proposition tells us that finitely presentable models are exactly objects in the end completion, which are retracts of representable objects. But this has a name in category theory. When you start from an arbitrary category and you add to this category all the retracts, which means you add an image of P for any idempotent element P. So this is the Karubi completion. This construction was introduced by Karubi. And so by now, this means that the category of set theoretic models of T which are finitely presentable is the Karubi completion of the category C opposite. And if we denote by M this Karubi completion, so this is a category of finitely presentable models, we get that the classifying topos of T is equivalent to the topos of Precis on the opposite category of M. And we also get that any set theoretic model is a filtering collimit of finitely presentable models. So for instance, any group is a filtering collimit of finitely presentable groups, of groups which are defined by a finite family of generators and relations. And the same for rings, for vector spaces, for any type of algebraic structure. So, so here we see that when pre-shift type theory T has its associated classifying topos presented as a topos of pre-shift at some C, then C is almost determined by T. It is determined by T up to Karubi completion. Okay, and by now we can begin to apply that to the problem of constructing of presenting the classifying toposes of a theory. So start from a theory, geometric theory T on a signature sigma. What we would want to do is to construct a Precis type theory T prime such that T is a quotient of T prime. So suppose we are able to do that. We just add to T, possibly some other sorts, symbol of functions, symbol of we don't change the language, but we remove some of the axioms. Okay, we want T to appear as a quotient of T prime. So T prime will have the same on language, but less axioms than T. And we would want to remove enough axioms so that T primes becomes of pre-shift type. And suppose by now that it is done, then we can consider the category M of finitely presentable set theoretic models of T prime. And then we get that the classifying topos of T prime would be equivalent to the topos of Precis on the opposite of M. And then, according to the correspondence between quotient theories and topologies, there would be a unique topology J on the opposite of M, such that the classifying topos of T is equivalent to the topos associated to the opposite of M endowed with the topology J. Okay? If we want to realize this program, we see that we need criteria for deciding whether a geometric theory T prime is of preshift type or not. So here I am going to present, in fact, two different criteria. First criterion, which is purely syntactic, which is a criterion written in the language of logic, and the second criterion, which is a criterion about the relationship, the special relationship of syntax and semantics in the case of preshift theories. So here I begin with the first syntactic, purely syntactic criterion. So for that, I consider an arbitrary geometric theory T together with its classifying topos associated to the syntactic category endowed with a syntactic topology. And let's consider the canonical functor from the syntactic category to the classifying topos. And we already said that this canonical functor L is fully faithful. By now, recall that the object of CT, by definition, are geometric formulas. The morphism of CT are geometric formulas which are T-provably functional up to T-provable equivalence. And lastly, the GT governing families are families of morphism whose unions of images is equal to everything. Okay, so I just recall that, and by now I introduce the following definition. An object of a topos is called irreducible if any globally epimorphic family from a family of objects to this object has a splitting. So this means that there should exist an index, I not, in the list of index of the family, such that the projection from EI not to E has a splitting, which means there is a morphism from E to EI not, whose composite with the projection is the identity of E. So if any covering family, if any globally epimorphic family in the topos verifies this property, we say that the object E is irreducible. So by now, we can translate this property in the language of sites. So if we have a small category C endowed with a topology J, we shall say an object X of C is irreducible with respect to the topology J if its only J covering sieve is a maximal sieve. And lastly, if we apply this general property to the particular case of the syntactic category of a geometric theory, we get the following definition. A geometric formula phi of X is called irreducible if it is irreducible as an object of the category CT with respect to the topology JT. Okay, and here we can remark that, of course, this definition we have just given in geometric language, in categorical language, can be translated into the language of probability, because we just make explicit what it means to be a covering family in the syntactic category, what it means to be a morphism. And so here I have written the meaning in terms of probability. You will see that in the slides Here the remark is complete. There is a complete statement of what it means. So it is quite, it is a little intricate. I don't say that it is a property which is easy to verify when you have a theory, but at least it is well defined. And here we have the following lemma, which once again is an illustration of the bridge technique. So these times you consider the classifying topos of some theory T, you suppose this topos is a pre-sheaf topos. So it is equivalent to the category of pre-sheaves on some category C. And the invariant you consider is the full subcategory of irreducible objects. And by now, you represent your topos in two ways. So on one side, from the syntactic category, CT, GT, and on the other side, from the category C, endowed with a discrete topology. So on the side C hat, we get that the irreducible objects of E are splittings of representable objects of the category C. So you see, in fact, here we get the same result. This is the same thing as finitely presentable models. You see, so here it is, this is really a result that, in fact, we get the same thing. And on the other side, computing the reducible object of the topos, we just get the reducible objects of the reducible formulas in the syntactic category. So which is a purely logical notion. So as a consequence of this lemma, there are some remarks to be made. So first, the fact that the Karubi completion of C is the full subcategory of the topos on irreducible objects. So this is just a rephrasing of the first characterization. And secondly, we get for such pre-sheaf type theory that there is a one-to-one correspondence between irreducible formulas and finitely presentable set-based models of the theory. So you see, this is really very remarkable because on one side, you have the notion of irreducible formula, which is a logical notion. And on the other side, you have the notion of finitely presentable model, which was defined as a purely semantic notion. It is defined purely in terms of set theoretic models. Okay. And then here we have the following first criterion, which is a purely syntactic criterion. So consider a geometric theory T. Then T is pre-sheaf type if and only if any geometric formula considered as an object of the syntactic category has a covering, admits a covering by formulas phi I, which are all irreducible. So you see the criterion, the syntactic criterion, is that a theory is pre-sheaf type if and only if any formula can be covered for the syntactic topology by irreducible formulas. Okay, so I don't give the proof of this theorem, but what I want to do now is to give the other criterion for a theory to be pre-sheaf type. So let's consider geometric theory on a signature sigma. And then the criterion is that this theory is pre-sheaf type if and only if the three following conditions are verified. Before stating them, I want to stress that all three conditions amount to saying that something which is defined on the syntactic sides correspond to some other thing which is defined purely in semantic terms. So the conclusion is really that a theory is of pre-shift type if and only if syntax and set-based semantics correspond to each other. Okay, so the first condition is the following. A geometric sequence of sigma is provable in the theory T if and only if it is verified by all set-based models. So remember that we have already said that for a geometric theory, a sequence is provable if and only if it is verified by the universal model in the classifying topos. But you see, this is a model in a topos, which of course is almost never the topos set. Here, we are saying that the first condition is that T provable, which is a syntactic notion, is equivalent to the fact that this sequence is verified by all set theoretic models. So this is the first condition. The second condition is the fact that any set theoretic model which is finitely presentable. So I remind you that finitely presentable means that the associated covariant functor respects filtering colimits. So you see, it is a categorical notion. And so the condition here is that finitely presentable models are finitely presented. And finitely presented by some irreducible geometric formula. Phi in some variables x1, xn. So what does it mean, finitely presented? It means that for any model n, the model morphism from m to n corresponds to families of elements in the sets na1, nan. You see the sets associated to the sorts A1, An in the model N. So families of elements which verify this formula. So you see, for instance, if you have a group generated, let's say, by two elements, J and H, verifying some formula, for instance, G to the square equal H to the power 3, then what is a group morphism from this group generated by this element with this relation to an arbitrary group, it is just, it corresponds to the choice of two elements in this group, which verifies the given formula. Okay, and here, this makes sense in an arbitrary setting. And so, if a formula has pre-shift type, in fact, any finitely presentable model is finitely presented by such a formula. So this is the second condition. And together with the third condition we will immediately give, it is equivalent for the theory to be of pre-shift type. So here is the third and last condition. For any sorts, in the signature, and for any map which associates to any finitely presentable model, a subset of the product set MA1 cross MAN in a functorial way. So this means that for any morphism of models from M to N, the induced map from MA1 from MAN to NA1 cross MAN sends the subset NP to the subset NP. So here you see P is any choice of subsets indexed by set theoretic, by finitely presented set-based models and which are functorial. And the third condition is that if we have such a functorial map, Then it is defined by a formula in the variable in variables of source A1, AN. Of course, in the reverse direction, it is obvious that if you have a family of subsets of the finitely presentable models, which is defined by a geometric formula, then it is functorial. But here, we have the reverse condition, that anything which is functorial is defined by a formula. And so the criterion for a theory, for a geometric theory to be pre-shift type, is that these three conditions are verified. It is an equivalence. So I remind you, the first condition is for the fact that you can check probability on set theoretic models. The second condition is that finitely presentable models are finitely presented by formulas, which in fact happen to be irreducible. And the third criterion is that functorial families of subsets in models are necessarily defined by formulas. Okay, so we can say a few words about the proof in the direct sense. So when we have a theory of pre-shift type, why are these properties verified? So in fact, it is a consequence of three bridges. So for the first, it was already done. We just have a classifying purpose, which by hypothesis is on the one hand, the topos of sheaves on the syntactic side. On the other hand, it is the topos of pre-sheaves on the opposite category of the category of set-based models, of finitely presented set-based models. Okay, so as a consequence of that, it is an immediate corollary, is that it is enough to check probability on set-based models. The second property comes from the bridge, which consists in computing the invariance of irreducible objects, both in the syntactic side and on the presentation sides by finitely presentable set-based models. And for the third property, you just consider the universal model of the universal model UT of the theory. And of course, UT associates to the sort A1, AN objects of the topos. And we can consider the product of these objects. And by now, we are interested in sub-objects of this product. So on the syntactic side, what we get is that sub-object of this product is just, they just are formulas. Because in the syntactic side, sub-objects are always formulas, okay? And on the semantic side, the presentation by the opposite category of the category of finitely presented set-based models. So you are in a pre-shift topos, and you have to just to understand what it means to be a sub-object of a certain pre-shift. And you get exactly what is written in condition three. Okay, so you get one direction of the theorem just by considering three bridges. Okay. So by now, if we gather what we have said, we have the following thing, the following process we can try to implement. Suppose we are considering a theory which is a quotient of another theory. So here I do not T prime, the quotient of T. And suppose we have proven that T is a pre-shift type theory. So for instance, by using one of the two last criteria. So in fact, in the book Theory Size of Topoises by Olivia, there are yet other criteria. In fact, there are many criteria for a theory to be of pressure type. So suppose you have applied one of these criteria, and you know that P is a pre-shift type theory. And as it is a pre-shift type theory, you know it's classifying topos. It is a topos of pre-shift on the opposite of the category of finitely presentable set-based models. Or you can also say that this opposite category is just the full subcategory of the syntactic category on irreducible formulas. So you see, this category M can be seen either as a semantic thing or as a syntactic thing. Okay, but then you see, because pre-shift type theories are really theories for which syntax and set theoretic semantics correspond to each other. And so by now, according to the general characterization of Cauchon theories in terms of topologies, we know that the classifying topos of the Cauchon theory T prime is equivalent to the topos of sheaves on this opposite category, M op, endowed with some topology J. And in fact, the topology J here can be made explicit. So here it is. You will say that a family of morphism between irreducible formulas. So you see a family of, this means a family of provably functional, of T provably functional formulas between irreducible formulas is a covering if and only if the corresponding sequence from phi to the bijunction of the images, which means the existential quantifier applied to the formulas theta is. So if this sequence is provable in the theory T prime. So be careful, you see in this statement, when I say that the theta is are provably functional from phi I to phi, here I am talking about T probability, okay? But then I say that the J is defined in the following way. So the sequence from phi to the disjunction of the existential quantifier applied to the theta is, so this sequence is T prime provable. And so, in fact, this defines a topology J on this category of irreducible formulas, and the classifying topos of T prime is the topos of sheaves defined by this topology on this category. So this gives you a way to present the classifying topos of T prime. But here I should stress that this representation is not unique. In fact, there are, as I already said, infinitely many theories, infinitely many presentations of the classifying topos. So this means that if I allow to replace T prime by a syntactically equivalent category, I will be able to present T prime in infinitely many ways as a quotient of pre-shift type theories. Okay, and each presentation of T prime as a quotient of a pre-shift type theory will give rise to a presentation of the associated classifying topos. Okay, and as soon as we have, you see, and, every presentation can be useful. There, in general, there is not a best presentation. In fact, the interest of the presentations depend on what you do. And in general, it is extremely useful to have many different presentations And these different presentations are related through their associated topologies. And this is exactly, so you see the idea of the bridge, such as here. Anytime you have two different presentations of a topos, and you consider an invariance, you can try to compute the invariance in the different presentations, and this will create a correspondence. And here, just because topologies are so general, we have seen that any geometric theory defines a topos. So this means that topologies are incredibly general. It is not topologies. This is not only for algebraic geometry. It is it can be defined everywhere in mathematics. So anytime you have a topos, and anytime you have different presentations of a topos, and for any invariant of any topos theoretic invariant you consider, this generates correspondences, equivalences. So this is really a principle whose generating power is absolutely huge. So Olivia says that this is some type of morphogenesis, of mathematical morphogenesis. So this means that you have a unifying principle, the principle of bridges, which depending on the topologies you consider, on the presentation of topologies you consider, on the invariants you consider, will generate extremely diverse results. Okay, and I think I hope at least that you have understood that topologies are extremely diverse. So you see, this theorem of existence of classifying topologies tells you that any geometric theory has a classifying topos. So you don't have to wonder whether it does exist or not. You know it always exists. But then the problem is to get more information on the topos. And a topos is a huge object. It is a category which is not small. So it is not possible to fully know a topos. But what we can hope to do is to extract some partial information on a topos by choosing concrete presentations and considering invariants which are meaningful for the type of problems you are considering. So this gives huge flexibility, okay? And so you will never exhaust all a topos, you will never know all the information contained in a topos, but you will be able to extract some information. And as soon as a topos is presented in different ways, which means through different sites or through different as a classifying topos of different theories. So usually what you will get is that this topos, which in some sense is mysterious, which you don't know, which is too big to be known, this topos is really a bridge between things which are concrete and meaningful. And then you will be able to relate two concrete things through an object which, in fact, is too big to be known. But this can be done as soon as you are able to compute or to express some invariance. So here, in what I have explained in my lectures, I think I have made clear that when we consider practical concrete theories, it is possible to produce concrete presentations of topologies, if only by syntactic sites. But in other parts of mathematics, different presentations of a topos may also appear. So for instance, I mentioned that next week there will be the talks by Clausen and Justin Clausen and Peter Scholzer. In fact, what they do in their talks is to introduce a particular topos. They call that the topos of condensed spaces. And they introduce this topos as the right context to study functional analysis in a better way. This is a new foundation for functional analysis. And in fact, when you begin to read the definitions, one of the first reasons why you understand this topos is a fine topos is the fact that it has two natural presentations. So one of these presentations is by the site of compact topological spaces. And the other presentation is by the site of profinite sets. So these are two very different sites with the same associated topos. And the fact that these two very natural sites generate the same topos is a very good reason to believe that this topos is especially interesting. Here, you see, I repeat the names. On the one hand, you have the site of compact topological spaces. So you see, this site belongs to topology. And on the other hand, you have the site of profinite sets. And this site is of combinatorial nature. So here, you have two different parts of mathematics. On the one hand, topology. On the other hand, combinatorics, which are related through a joint topos they both define. Okay, so this is an example. But once again, there are infinitely many toposes, and for each topos, infinitely many presentations, and on toposes, infinitely many invariants you may be interested in. So this is really a principle for producing a huge diversity of results in mathematics. Okay, so thank you for your attention. I think this is the end of my lectures.
Thank you, Laurent.